All right, so welcome everyone. We're doing a little something kind of unexpected this morning or this afternoon. Due to some technical issues, the class that was supposed to happen today on Hyder Ali and India's forgotten independence movement has jumped ahead 7 days into the future, leaving a certain vacuum. So I decided to fill that vacuum with a presentation that I had the pleasure of giving with Cynthia Chung on August 15th in Vancouver, dealing with a component of the battle in world's history between these two paradigms, these two systems that concentrated itself at a certain moment at the end of World War II between the figures of Franklin Roosevelt and his allies versus Winston Churchill. This is part of a series for, I think everybody here is aware, we've been doing for the past 2 months an ongoing series of weekly lectures on a harmony of interest, inquiries into the true nature of the American system. Obviously, America is going through a major existential crisis. Its future is very undetermined. We have people coming at the crises that are befalling the world from a multitude of very confused pathways. Obviously, there's certain figures who believe that if we only had total free markets, you know, this libertarian view of things, the world would be kosher and everything would be fine. Other people have this opposing view that we need to have top-down, you know, socialist controls, a return to communism, and that can only impose order onto the chaos of the impending economic meltdown, which one would really have to be a fool or really try hard not to see that this is coming onto us. And we have things like that coming out of, you know, certain individuals in the city of London, around the Bank of International Settlements, the Bank of England, a lot of the Wall Street crowd, and different figures who think that a Green New Deal would be the perfect solution to have a great global reset of the world economy. So then you have that. So you have these two different pathways to deal with the oncoming collapse. Then you have the third option, which we see anarchistically tearing down statues, spreading across the United States especially, but also in Canada and in Europe, where there is a real threat of just total anarchy, a Jacobin anarchy, just to tear down. A lot of these people being swept into this mob mentality are not bad people. They're not George Soros types. They don't know what they're a part of. They just know that they've been abused. They've been wronged systemically for a long time. And they're easily just falling into these sorts of rapturous chaos movements, which are actually being orchestrated, as all mob movements have always been orchestrated for thousands of years, from the top. And so you have the chaos anarchistic view that maybe through the ashes of destruction, a new order of justice will mystically emerge. So you got these three options and different flavors in between, but really you've got that. Then we have what Trump did at the Republican Party convention, where he not only tried to invoke, and I think did so very well. I read the transcript of his speech, and it was sharp, you know, and he invoked the image of Abraham Lincoln, the need to unite Republicans of the Lincoln bent, Democrats, independents around who are patriotic and who want to preserve the Republic from collapse, around a new mission for the world. And he really called forth a space program, and he identified the Artemis program as the new form of sort of 21st century manifest destiny, to go to the horizons of human knowledge and economic limits, and then leap beyond them by putting a woman on the moon for the first time in 2024, as the current schedule has it outlined, and then soon thereafter a Mars colony. This would be done according to the Artemis Manifesto, the Artemis Accords that have been released a few months ago, based upon protocols that would involve international cooperation between the public and the private sector, but also between nations of Russia, China, other countries of the world, around these aims that are in the benefit of everybody. So obviously space is a very important domain. I think we all here, at least on this call, have discovered that that is really one of the only ways that we're going to be able to reinfuse our pessimistic culture of post-industrialism with the vital spirit needed to take on missions that go beyond and transcend our lifetimes and give hope and larger meaning to our children and grandchildren and civilization at large. This is something which Russia and China have really embraced. So both countries have engaged in cooperative space policies for building a joint lunar base within the decade. There's policies for asteroid defense, which we desperately need, and other astrophysical issues. Having the U.S. join is a really important way to redefine what the new economic system will have to look like and what values will have to be based upon as we transition from the neoliberal collapsing economic order into something more befitting human civilization, something more based upon natural law and the ideas of creativity that all human beings have a right to access within themselves. So with that, I think that the historic precedents are very important. In her presentation, Cynthia went through a beautiful presentation going from the battles that were taking place between the Venetian party that was just recently taking over London, who were in opposition to the humanist Platonic scholars and statesmen like Jonathan Swift, Leibniz specifically, and how these networks, specifically she discussed Leibniz, were influencing the Russian culture and Russian government through Tsar Peter the Great, who went on to found the Russian Academy of Sciences based upon the Leibnizian program. She jumped ahead into the battles that were being waged in the 1770s and 1780s when Ben Franklin was organizing an American Revolution. The person of Ekaterina Dashkova, the first female president of the Russian Academy of Sciences and one of its greatest reformers, it seems, ever, who had a very close alliance and friendship with Franklin was discussed, where Franklin was made a member of that Russian Academy and Dashkova was made a member, the first Russian member of Franklin's Philosophical Society, which was more than just a philosophical society as we tend to think of it today. It was all based upon the unification of art, science, and statecraft into a movement internationally. And we had people like Lafayette, Alexander von Humboldt, scientists, artists, scholars, statesmen from around the world who are part of this thing. And it's much more than people realize. So Cynthia went through that story. She went through the work that Alexander von Humboldt did with his brother to reform the education system and also create a new science based upon certain ideals of aesthetics that were advanced by Schiller and applied to create and advance new discoveries in natural sciences throughout the 19th century. And this led up all the way through to the election of Lincoln. Now, I'm going to be tackling for the majority of my presentation the battle that happened from the 1930s and 40s, but I do want to say a few, I want to begin with this battle here 100 years earlier with the Humboldt School of Political Science that had taken power with Lincoln. I'm just going to do a screen share. Here we are. Sure. Can people see this? Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm just going to do a full screen. All right. So right here, the title is The FDR Wall is a Vision for a Multipolar World. This is the world that should have been, that we still hope that can become today, but that was sabotaged in 1945-46. Wallace is somebody I'm going to go through a lot in this presentation, as is FDR. And we're going to tie this into what Lincoln was doing. But first, before anything, I'd like to just get across that the world that we live in is not the world that should have been. And a lot of people, I get a little annoyed sometimes, you know, hearing this often repeated belief that what happened in the past had to happen because it created the present. Now that is a completely incompetent, I think, belief in history, because it denies free will, it denies any understanding of how history actually works, and nothing had to happen the way it happened, for good or for bad. The post-war order that we know of, Oh, hold on. The post-war order that we know of should have been based, when you actually look at the fights that were waging by people like Wallace and FDR, on a win-win principle of cooperation instead of Hobbesian geopolitics, Cold War thinking, nuclear terror. None of that was necessary. In fact, a lot of very artificial interventions had to happen to disrupt the natural flow of human evolution that was happening at that moment. To get across this point, I'm going to play a little short video. It's no longer than 2.5 minutes, which I'm going to do in a second here.
This is a fight between a slave world and a free world. Just as the United States in 1862 could not remain half slave and half free, so in 1942 the world must make its decision for a complete victory one way or the other. Down the years, the people of the United States have moved steadily forward in the practice of democracy. When the freedom-loving people march, when the farmers have an opportunity to buy land at reasonable prices and to sell the produce of their land through their own organizations, when the workers have the opportunity to form unions and bargain through them collectively, and when the children of all the people, these opportunities are open to everyone, then the world moves straight ahead. But the march of freedom of the past 150 years has been a long drawn out people's revolution. This great revolution of the people, there were the American Revolution of 1775, the French Revolution of 1792, the Latin American revolutions of the Bolivarian era, the German Revolution of 1848, the Russian Revolution of 1918. Each spoke for the common man in terms of blood on the battlefield. Some went to excess. But the significant thing is that the people groped their way to the light. The people are on the march toward even fuller freedom than the most fortunate peoples of the earth have hitherto enjoyed. The people, in their millennial and revolutionary march toward manifesting here on earth the dignity that is in every human soul, hold as their credo the four freedoms enunciated by President Roosevelt. We who live in the United States may think there is nothing very revolutionary about freedom of religion, freedom of expression, and freedom from the fear of secret police. But when we begin to think about the significance of freedom from want for the average man, then we know that the revolution of the past 150 years has not been completed, either here in the United States or in any other nation in the world. We know that this revolution cannot stop until freedom from want has been attained.
All right, so does everyone know who that was?
Yep.
Okay, so Henry Wallace, speaking as he was in 1942, was one of the leading top allies of FDR, who I think understood FDR's plan to create a post-war world order after the U.S. would be able to put down the Wall Street, City of London-funded fascist machine. That's a whole class unto itself. But he understood this vision better than anybody, except for maybe FDR. And what he's enumerating with these four freedoms was what infused the principle into the Atlantic Charter, that defined the idea that the post-war world was going to be based upon ending hunger, ending all fears, these four freedoms of Roosevelt, the ending the fear of secret police, having actual a sense of security for all people, regardless of what nation or culture you come from, having freedom of faith, whatever faith you worship, you have the right to your conscience, freedom from war, and freedom from what was the other one? Forgetting it.
Want.
Fear and want. Okay. So these were not just, as they're often attacked today, they were not just idealistic utopian ideas sitting in the clouds, devoid from any real understanding of the reality of the geopolitical nature of man. These were actually very practicable, and they are still very practical. And in fact, one could say that unless we actually accept their truthfulness, mankind's moral fitness to live in this world, in this universe, will not be ensured. So that's a precondition for our survival itself. What I think is important as well is that Wallace is invoking the image of Abraham Lincoln, who understood, as he says, that America couldn't coexist half slave, half free. And he's making the case that the world today in 1942 can't exist half slave, half free. And he's referring to colonialism. Lincoln didn't differentiate the slave master system in America with the colonial subject system in the world either. In many of Lincoln's speeches, as well as those of his allies and leading advisors, we're going to see one of them. It was clearly understood that these two systems were the same system, and that's why it was also understood that British intelligence, the City of London, were the primary supporters of the slave power in the United States and the backers in the U.S. Civil War that always aimed to undermine what Ben Franklin had established in 1776 to 83 and what Leibniz had strove to create with his Eurasian vision as well. So one of those characters, I think many of us have had a chance to read some of his writings, maybe some of us haven't yet. Henry C. Carey was the son of Matthew Carey, who was a Republican revolutionary who was recruited by Ben Franklin from Ireland. And he was a follower of the thinking of Jonathan Swift. Matthew Carey, his father, was the leading champion of manufacturers for Ireland. And it was understood that when Ben Franklin brought him to France in 1780, when Ben Franklin was the ambassador and was also meeting with Ekaterina Dashkova and the Russian intelligentsia, Matthew Carey was assigned the role of printing and distributing propaganda, organizing literature to organize the revolution in America, but with the preparation that with America's successful creation of a republic, that France would soon follow thereafter. Followed, and that the success of Marquis de Lafayette and the Ben Franklin networks in France would then be able to create a beachhead whereby Ireland would soon follow suit and establish a republic free of empire as well. This was Jonathan Swift's idea, and it was always tied to the economic liberation of the society through manufacturers, which obviously when you have a manufacturing society, you're able to activate much greater degrees of cognitive power of your labor force, and you rely less and less on human slave labor to do your work, right? So that idea of value that came from this fight for political freedom was inextricably tied to the fight for economic independence, to protectionism of your local manufacturing and agriculture, the application of machinery. So Matthew Carey, who became the leading champion of the Hamiltonian system of political economy after the revolution, which we got to see 2 weeks ago when Nancy Spanis gave her wonderful introduction to Alexander Hamilton and what he did. After Hamilton's assassination in 1804, Matthew Carey was one of the leading champions, and his works probably saved the United States from dissolution on a number of occasions after 1804. He gave the torch to his son, who took it, he took this on and devoted his entire life from 1830 all the way till his death in 1879 to the cause of not only fighting for this system in America itself and stopping the different British intelligence deep state, we can call them a proto deep state operations from undoing the revolution of 1776, but he also fought to apply this internationally too. And he understood that this was a paradigm shift for all of mankind. It was not a purely American right. You know, the idea that you don't have to have a hereditary order. Who says that a hereditary order should determine your your rights and powers, whether you're born into a slave family or a master family. That's an offense to conscience and an offense to natural law. Carrie and these people who actually maintained the fight for a republic throughout this very tumultuous 19th century understood that. And they understood that this is the right for everybody from Africa, from South America, Asia, and beyond. So Carrie in 1852, it would only be 8 years when the Civil War would break out, but it was already understood that this is where things were going, and it was a global international clash. He writes in his book, The Harmony of Interest, which is available on archive.org, and it's also available on the Rising Tide Foundation website in the Library of Alexandria, the famous often cited quote that I just love, that two systems are before the world. The one looks to increasing the proportion of persons and of capital engaged in trade and transportation, and therefore to diminishing the proportion engaged in producing commodities with which to trade, with necessarily diminished returns to the labor of all, while the other looks to increasing the proportion engaged in the work of production and diminishing that engaged in trade and transportation with increased returns to all, giving to the labor good wages and to the owner of capital good profits. One looks to pauperism, ignorance, depopulation, and barbarism. The other, in increasing wealth, comfort, intelligence, combination of action, and civilization. One looks towards universal war, the other towards universal peace. The one is the English system. The other we may be proud to call the American system, for it is the only one ever devised, the tendency of which was that of elevating while equalizing the condition of man throughout the world. Right. So, okay. As we know, oops, that's too soon. As we know, this clash resulted finally in the miraculous dark horse candidate, Abraham Lincoln, who took the reins of power of the presidency and was inaugurated in 1861. The moment of the announcement of his candidacy or his victory, in 1860, the five Confederate states seceded from the Union, and that they were soon joined by others. And the vice president of the Confederate States of America made the announcement that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are not created equal, and goes on to produce a very disgusting diatribe enunciating the principles upon which the hoped for Confederacy was going to found itself. Of course, the British were all too happy to support militarily with intelligence and also through their operations all over Halifax, Montreal, Toronto, in British Canada. They were happy to support the Confederate cause and also economically by all measure. So Lincoln and Carey, his leading economist and ally, had a lot on their plate. Their victory resulted in, and this is going to be the topic of an upcoming paper I should be publishing, or I should be up on Strategic Culture later this week. But the victory of this battle and the reactivation of Hamilton's American system in America through the greenbacks, through the controls of federal credit, and the application of internal improvements that superseded British free trade theories of deregulation and whatever the market wants, the market gets logic. This saved America. There were a lot of battles along the way over those 4 years. But when America came out victorious, largely again through the help of the Russians, which Cynthia also went through wonderfully in her class in Vancouver, it was well understood that this was not going to stop there. Even though the British were able to get in their traitors, like Andrew Johnson, when Lincoln died, and a lot of Lincoln's immediate reforms for Reconstruction were undone in the wake of his murder, and the slave power, which had just been defeated, was given new liberties, new powers to reclaim much of their influence politically and culturally. In spite of that, there was a huge momentum that wasn't stoppable very easily. The greenback system finally was halted with the Specie Resumption Act in 1871 that tied America's credit to gold, and soon the greenbacks were taken out of circulation through Wall Street operations that ensured that America's credit was not going to be permitted to have the type of effect that it did under Lincoln, or that it had once done under the Hamiltonian national banks that were killed by Jackson earlier. In spite of that fact, though, the cultural momentum towards the belief in progress, the belief in development, that human population growth was actually a good thing, not a bad thing, because we are a species of creative discovery and invention when you give us the opportunity. This allowed America's population to skyrocket threefold within 30 years. The rail system in America increased threefold as well, to something like, I think it was 168,000 kilometers, miles of rail by 1898, which far outpaced all of Europe combined. That's up from the 48,000 miles that existed in 1865. The Transcontinental Railway was the strongest driver. It was sort of like the science Apollo mission crash driver during the war that it was begun, to, for the first time, unite a continent ocean to ocean. And followers, the a lot of the key figures in Russia who worked to save the Union around Tsar Alexander II, were also adherents of the Kerry Lincoln program, and they brought this enthusiastically, this whole Hamiltonian system, into Russia with Sergei Vita, who led and spearheaded the development of the Trans-Siberian Railway of Russia. Other followers like Gabriel Hanotaux, Otto von Bismarck in Germany, and others worked to apply this in Europe to break free of British manipulations. And we had people in Asia and Japan doing this. Later on in China, you had Sun Yat-sen, who vigorously studied this and applied it to the best of his ability, though he was subverted from much of that grand design he laid out in 1919 in his international development of China. But he entirely followed the Lincoln-Kerry program. So this was an international system of cooperation, the domestication of the economic beast, such that value and money was tied to the improvements of nations and of people. So why simply make a profit and say that that profit can only exist with or without people getting hurt, as we see with today's practices and economic behavior that they teach in school? The only economic behavior that should be permitted are the types of profits and investments which improve the conditions of life of people, as well as make investors a profit. Doing so really clearly breaks the Marxian clash of classes, the class struggle that the Marx followers believe is an absolute constant in the universe. So you can get a harmony of interest, as Henry C. Carey pointed out in his book, if you approach it from this paradigm. So what did this look like? Well, one of Lincoln's key allies, the first governor of Colorado, as when it was still a territory, Governor Gilpin, who actually did a lot to save the Union from dissolution, drafted a book called The Cosmopolitan Railway in 1890, which took on the a program, much like what Leibniz's Eurasian Development Program did in 1710 to 1714. Gilpin's program was very similar in its spirit, and the means to carry out this new paradigm of civilization, which would involve connecting the rails of America through Canada, through the Bering Strait, into Eurasia. And he describes this at length in this 400-page wonderful book. There's some problems in the book, but overall, it's just people knew that this is where the world was going. Sergei Vita, the transport minister and later prime minister of Russia, understood this. Tsar Nicholas II commissioned American engineers to carry out feasibility studies in 1906 around the Bering Strait connection. The British, people like Halford Mackinder, who founded modern geopolitics, studied this and understood that this would be a threat to the British Empire's existence and had to be destroyed. Lord Milner from the Roundtable Movement, the Rhodes Trust Networks, studied this and recognized that this had to be destroyed because empire could not coexist, and they knew it if this was permitted to happen. So this brings us back here to a quick run through. Historically, that didn't happen. So that was that map we saw of the world land bridge of Gilpin, his economic just and correct map of the world, as he called it, was disrupted by a series of artificial interventions that didn't have to happen. And the, you know, the ignorance of their artificial intervention of these things, it has prevented the creative thoughts of a lot of people living today from thinking through properly what are the solutions and the means to solving the fires that are engulfing today's world as we sit, unfortunately, on the verge of a new Third World War. So what happened? Well, number one, Lincoln's last real self-conscious champion and follower of his full program, President McKinley, was assassinated, as people know. And Martin Seif, who we had the pleasure of listening to his wonderful lecture a few weeks ago, he just published on the Strategic Culture Foundation a wonderful article. It's the feature article of the day. I suggest everyone read it, on the assassination of McKinley and how British anarchist operations, which also had previously killed Alexander II in 1880 or 81, and also Garfield in America in that same year, carried out the assassination of McKinley that were tied to Emma Goldman, but other London-protected anarchists that I don't think anybody has properly identified. So McKinley's murder at the hands of one of these anarchist mindless disciples of Emma Goldman really disrupted the flow of the Gilpin vision. What happened? I mean, as we know, a British-loving stooge named Theodore Roosevelt, a eugenics-loving imperialist, took over control of the presidency, much in the same way that a stooge like Andrew Johnson had taken over the presidency when Lincoln died, and a later stooge took over the presidency when FDR died. That tends to happen. Now, Theodore Roosevelt created an Anglo-American relationship and really undid all of the programs for protectionism, for development of colonized people that Lincoln and that McKinley had wished to see occur. Theodore Roosevelt undid a lot of that and just reasserted an Anglo-American imperial control of much of the world, as much of it as he could justify, at least. In 1905, Russia experienced their first color revolution. It wasn't the big one, but it was big enough to pretty much disrupt the Trans-Siberian rail development as it was supposed to continue on to its next phases. It had finished, it was completed in 1905, that same year. British, again, intelligence, anarchistic operations within Russia. A lot of material has been written on this by, in EIR by Jeff Steinberg. Maybe I could put that as a link to the class. But these disrupted that. They undid Sergei Vita's power. And by 1914, World War I was launched, the most unnecessary war in all of human civilization's experience, as far as I know, where all of the allies, Germany, Russia, who were all Lincoln allies just a few years earlier, ended up at each other's throats in years of massacre. I write 1971, that's a typo. Obviously, 1917, Russia suffers from its second color revolution, and Tsar Nicholas II and his family are murdered. The dreams of the, I mean, at this point, forget about any transcontinental railway. That's the least, the potential for that happening at this point is probably as low as it's ever been. The Roundtable Movement, which had just taken control of Britain, Lord Milner and his little coterie of imperialists orchestrate the Treaty of Versailles to impose irreparable, unpayable war reparations onto Germany, as people know. And there's a moment of hope where in something called the Rapallo Accords are organized by leaders of Russia who had come in with Lenin, as well as certain other people in other countries. But primarily it's a Russian German alliance to erase the unpayable war debts and instead create an investment strategy based upon internal improvements, increase of productivity, and cooperation amongst nations. As far as I can see, President Harding of America, who in many ways followed the McKinley program, was in favor of this majorly, and he orchestrated with leading industrialists in Russia and in Germany at that time, the biggest $3 billion trade agreement in history. It was big. In 1923, it was solidified. And that was supposed to be a driver for the rehabilitation of the sovereign nation states of Russia, China, and America together. Now, unfortunately, Walter Rathenau, the son of the great German industrialist Emil Rathenau, who was a follower of Frederick List and Hamilton, he was assassinated. Harding dies mysteriously of oysters on a train. Dirty work was behind that. Lenin dies under mysterious circumstances too, and Lenin had his problems, but at the very least one could say that he did want the industrial and scientific development of Russia. He did fight for electrification of rural parts of Russia. He didn't go with the Trotskyite view of turn Russia into a, well, anyway, that's another story. Anyway, he dies. So this whole potential, again, for the trade agreement, for the Apollo Accords, goes out the window. America, with the death of Harding, becomes a free market, speculative, everything goes basket case of broker call loans that become multiplied 6, 7, 8 fold by 1929, where brokers are taking out loans far beyond their capacity to repay for speculative purposes. Legitimate savings and other assets are speculated upon, specifically starting with the housing market in America. And this results in a giant bubble, which is popped in 29. Sorry, that's another typo. So at that point, that coordinated blowout of the bubbles that became the financial system results in the Great Depression. And it was a controlled blowout. I mean, there was a mass coordination by Wall Street, by London, to at the same time in the same day call in all the broker call loans, which they was known could not be paid, and the chain reaction defaults that occurred deleveraged the whole system, and everyone got to discover very quickly that the whole thing is a giant fraud. Meanwhile, the German economy is being set up to bring a total fascist world order into place. There, you know, because Rapallo had been destroyed, Rapallo is based on the Italian city where the negotiations between the Russians and the Germans were orchestrated. Because that had been sabotaged earlier, Germany went hyperinflation down that path. Their economy became a total basket case. Trillions of dollars is what it took you to buy a loaf of bread. And this solution was brought in by London in 1923 under the Rentenmark. So people could just bring in their wheel baskets full of useless paper money, of Reichsmarks, get some Rentenmarks for them at highly reduced value. So people were robbed again. And now there was a new financial set of rules under Hjalmar Schacht, the finance minister of Germany, who obeyed always the city of London. Now that had created a condition where fascism, the Nazi party, grew and grew. Again, supported by the Bush family, other networks around Montague Norman in London. So that was during the 1920s, and the U.S. was going into Great Depression mode. So what was the solution to the Great Depression? Obviously, fascism. So that was the big economic miracle. Mussolini found his face on Time magazine 6 times by 1933 as the big economic miracle for America. Canada was being fed Adrien Arcand's growing, Quebec Nazi movement as their solution to putting food on your plate. Federal Canada, English Canada was being set up to have a Rhodes Scholar Trust. It's called the Canadian Fabian Society, set up by 6 Rhodes Scholars, called the League of Social Reconstruction, was being set up to take control here as well, to give people order under scientific management of society. Again, the fact that eugenics played a prominent role in that scientific management is not a coincidence. And also not detached from the logic underlying COP26 coming up in London, or the current Green New Deal fraud, which is being fed to a lot of credulous people today. Population control is always what underlies this agenda. So that was the solution. Roosevelt was the dark horse candidate that Lincoln played. That was the role that Lincoln played in 1861. Roosevelt became that dark horse candidate who took, luckily, power in 1932 with his election. Now, a little fun fact, many people don't know, and again, we began this whole presentation with the idea that nothing had to happen in history. I brought up the Apollo Accords. that could have avoided the hyperinflationary breakdown in Germany, that only was stopped because of assassinations. Well, Germany at the same time in 1932 had their own elections, and they voted for a friend of Walter Rathenau, who was a co-architect of the Rapallo Accords with Russia 10 years earlier, named Kurt von Schleicher. That's it. Sorry, mental fart. Kurt von Schleicher was nominated he was elected and became the Chancellor of Germany in a surprise election in 1932. With Schleicher came in all of the allies of Walter Rathenau, especially who concentrated around Lautenbach and the Frederick List Society of Germany, who had a program in 1932 to do essentially what Roosevelt ended up doing in America in that same period, of a New Deal for Germany. It was all vectored upon the Frederick List, who was, you know, as Cynthia went through in her class, it's great, people should watch that. It is a program for applying Alexander Hamilton's system of protective tariffs, internal improvements, productive credit to Germany. That was going to be what Schleicher applied, not fascism. So Roosevelt also takes power, and a fight is waged to stop a banker's dictatorship. So that's what I have here. That's the last thing on my little timeline. The London Conference is announced in 1932. This is a conference organized by the League of Nations, which was entirely a Milner roundtable baby. It was set up in 1919 as a way to take over controls from sovereign nation states and create a one world government where sovereign nations would have no power over military or economic affairs. It would be a new bankers controlled world government run by technocrats. So the London Conference was set up by the Bank of International Settlements and the League of Nations, two British oligarchical instruments, as a way to stabilize currencies and to deal with the calamity of the Great Depression that spread at this time all over Europe. In all of the dispatches from the London Conference, which featured 65 nations being absorbed into this, mostly from the British Empire, obviously, but others in Europe, the whole policy was to give over sovereign controls from nations to the Bank of International Settlements as the central bank of central banks to coordinate world policy top down. Now, unfortunately, Roosevelt had other ideas. So did von Schleicher. In the case of Germany, Schleicher was unexpectedly ousted in a soft coup in January 1933 when a very corrupt and stupid head of Germany, Kaiser, made Hitler the chancellor, and Schleicher was out. There's some really excellent material on EIR that goes through a lot of this story. I'll put this in the links in the description section of this video. But Schleicher is ousted, Hitler comes in, and FDR suffers his first near miss of an assassination. So February in 1933, an Italian anarchist Freemason, Giuseppe Zingara, tries to shoot the new president before he's inaugurated, standing alongside Mayor Cermak of Chicago. A woman, luckily in the audience, sees this gun come out, hits the guy's hand, and the five shots miss Roosevelt, but they do hit the mayor, who dies 30 days later. My battery's about to die. Forgive me. I'll be right back. Okay, I'm going through a lot of material here, guys. Is everyone so far following in general the plot line?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So Roosevelt survives. What happened to McKinley does not happen to Roosevelt as these British-controlled anarchists had planned. Roosevelt survives and goes on to begin a major battle with Wall Street and with the City of London. This occurs over the course of his first 100 days, which involves one of the most sweeping reforms of American finance in history. Actually, no, this is something which is not just in America, because he runs a dual fight in London. So while he's in the middle of battling Wall Street at home, he's also doing battle with the London Conference and the League of Nations abroad. So the London Conference is something which he single-handedly torpedoes marvelously. And I'm just going to get a little quote here. I'm just going to edit this little... sorry, I should just... Give me 2 seconds. There he is. Okay. So Roosevelt announces that the London Conference is really just contaminated with, quote, old fetishes of so-called international bankers. He says in this speech, the United States seeks the kind of dollar which a generation hence will have the same purchasing and debt-paying power as the dollar value we hope to attain in the near future. That objective means more to the good of other nations than a fixed ratio for a month or two. This is not the answer. So the London Conference is all entirely focused on mechanism. And FDR makes the point, no, I mean, it's about an economic recovery is about more than just monetary theory. And it requires a total overhaul. What he does in America to deal with the 25% or more unemployment, the loss of 70% of industrial capacity, was all shut down during the Great Depression. 4,000 banks had failed. People lost their life savings, suicides were skyrocketing, crime was skyrocketing. It was total despair, and that's why fascism was taking hold. What Roosevelt did is, in his 100 days, he first spearheaded and basically sabotaged the London Conference, said that U.S. would not participate in any of these fetishes of the international bankers, and the London Conference, in a few months' time, was just canceled. The British were like, well, we can't do anything if we can't get the U.S. to go on board. So the conference was dissolved. Nothing was accomplished, and sovereignty was defended. Inside of America, Roosevelt fights. He imposes Glass-Steagall to break up the speculative banks and force an audit of the banks, so that for the first time, federally sanctioned teams of auditors were able to go in and see which debts incurred by the banks were legitimate and which ones were not. The Pecora Commission under Ferdinand Pecora was deployed by Roosevelt and empowered with maximum powers to bring international financiers, including Jean-Pierrepont Morgan Jr., into trial, and expose how these bankers self-consciously ran criminally the Great Depression and before that all of the bubbles of the 20s that gambled with other people's money, much like Wall Street has done today since Glass-Steagall especially has been repealed in 1999. He created the Security and Exchange Commission to have mass oversight on Wall Street banks and put the banks through bankruptcy reorganization by a bank holiday over 2 weeks. Those that were completely insolvent were basically shut down, but those that were somehow solvent, which included about 75% of the banks, were saved, rehabilitated, brought in, new management was brought in, and new practices of issuing loans and credit were created, largely through this newly regulated system. The focus and the thing that made this work wasn't the individual mechanisms of the New Deal itself. And this is something that a lot of people who are falling prey to the Green New Deal, they get sucked into, because the Green New Deal, promoted by the likes of Nancy Pelosi, George Soros, Bill Gates, has a lot of similar outward mechanisms as the FDR New Deal in terms of bank regulation, things like, you know, dirigistic practices of credit issuance. The thing that it lacks, though, is the understanding that Roosevelt had that the credit only has value if it's tied to increasing the productive powers of labor. So you have to do things, force the money and the investments to be put into places that will, in reality, over the long term, create an upgrade, an upshift of that nation's capacity to sustain its own existence, right? And so his Four Corners projects of the Tennessee Valley Authority in the Northeast, the Colorado Basin programs of dam building in the the Tennessee Valley is in the Southeast, the Colorado River Basin in the Northwest, the St. Lawrence Seaway area in the northeast, and also the Hoover Dam programs in the southeast, west. Hard to keep that in my mind. These were sort of like the Belt and Road Initiative of its day, the macro design for America that defined all of the thousands of other smaller infrastructure projects that put 4 million people to work in the first month under Harry Hopkins' Public Works Administration. An FDR ally named Mariner Eccles, who was a very good man, was imposed onto the Federal Reserve. So for the first time since 1913, the private Federal Reserve had to abide by an actual pro-industrial, pro-nation state head of that bank. So national controls were put onto this otherwise independent entity. And that forced the Federal Reserve, though there was not always, but it forced the Federal Reserve's hand in large measure to abide by FDR's demands. He also created the Reconstruction Finance Corporation as well, which provided something by the end of the mid-1940s, the Reconstruction Finance Corporation had accounted for over half of the investments in America into industrial and infrastructure credit using treasury-backed bonds that were then tied to the development of the nation. All of these things were transformative in ways that money cannot account. And you could see that in places like Tennessee, where a 20% illiteracy that was prevalent in 1932 went all the way, it went down into and became, 80% illiteracy in Tennessee, in the Tennessee backwater south, went down to become less than 15% by the 1950s, when this whole backwater racist prone area became a hub for aerospace and industrial development. That's very, very important. And that has a lot to do with the massive dams and electrification projects. So it was qualitative. It was located in the understanding that the mind was the source of value of the economy. I'm about halfway through my presentation now, but I'm going to shift gears. Because at the beginning of the presentation, I had these three guys. The nature of the fight had, I really felt like this was a very important part of this presentation, just to get across the context of this fight, when there was a choice over what the post-war order was going to be. I skipped, obviously, all the details about how the war was won. I think that this story has been told very competently in other places. Needless to say, Hitler lost, and the city of London was largely unhappy with that outcome, but not entirely, because they were able to do certain things that created a perversion of history, which we're going to explore. Now, in a lot of these pictures from 1943, where you see the three big guys, Churchill, Stalin, and Roosevelt, Roosevelt is always in the middle. In all pictures you will find with these three, you will never have Churchill and Stalin next to each other. Cynthia is preparing a report on this fascinating alliance and understanding between the two men, Stalin and Churchill, who both recognized commonly that, sorry, I'm bad with names, but you knew what I meant. Stalin and Roosevelt. They both knew that Churchill was poison and would undo whatever, basically would destroy both Russia and America if his movement for empire was permitted to succeed. He could not be trusted and had to always be kept at arm's length. Later on, Chiang Kai-shek from China and the Chinese intelligentsia understood this too, which is why Roosevelt had a vision, which I'll get to a little bit later in detail. So what did Roosevelt really want? Well, there's a very famous document called As He Saw It, written by Elliot Roosevelt, Roosevelt's son, who was also his aide and confidant, who was there at the Tehran conference at Casablanca and understood better also what this fight was really about. And he recorded the debates, the fights that happened between Churchill and Roosevelt. I'm going to have a series of quotes that were documented by Eliot. This book was published in 1946. Eliot had seen that the vision his father had fought for and died for was disappearing fast. So he wrote this book. He's now documenting during I believe this is the Casablanca conference. he documents an interaction with his father, and his father is really communicating the point of the war. Why is America now in it? And FDR says to Elliot, I'm talking about another war, Elliot. I'm talking about what will happen to our world if after this war, we allow millions of people to slide back into the same semi-slavery. Also, keep in mind what Henry Wallace had said during his speech on the Four Freedoms, right? Don't think for a moment, Elliot, that Americans would be dying in the Pacific tonight if it hadn't been for the short-sighted greed of the French and the British and the Dutch. Shall we allow them to do it all over again? Your son will be about the right age, 15 or 20 years from now. One sentence, Elliot, then I'm going to kick you out of here. I'm tired. It was obviously late at night. He had a long day. This is my sentence. When we've won the war, I will work with all my might and main to see to it that the United States is not wheedled into the position of accepting any plan that will further France's imperialistic ambitions or that will aid or abet the British Empire in its imperial ambitions. Okay, so the next day now rolls around and there's a confrontation between FDR and Churchill. There's gonna be three people I'll need who are willing to read aloud in a slightly dramatic form if possible. I need a Roosevelt, I need a Churchill, I need a narrator. Jerry, would you like to be Roosevelt? Yeah. Bob, you want to be Churchill?
Sure.
How's your British accent, Bob?
I guess I can do something. We'll see.
Don't force it if you can. Just be evil. Yeah. Okay, and we need a narrator. So who wants to be a narrator? Kevin, are you there?
Yeah, okay.
No, I need a narrator. Doug.
I will be narrator.
Oh, okay, I got an Evan. Evan will be narrator, okay. Okay, so narrator, okay, so we've got now, see if we can follow this. All right, so Roosevelt starts.
After the war, one of the preconditions of any lasting peace will have to be the greatest possible freedom of trade.
Narrator.
He paused. The PM's head was lowered. He was watching Father steadily from under one eyebrow.
FDR.
No artificial barriers. As few favored economic agreements as possible. Opportunities for expansion. Markets open for healthy competition.
His eye wandered innocently around the room. Churchill shifted in his armchair.
The British Empire trade agreements,
he began heavily,
are...
Father broke in.
Yes. Those Empire trade agreements are a case in point. It's because of them that the people of India and Africa and all the colonial Near East and Far East are still as backward as they are.
Churchill's neck reddened and he crouched forward.
Mr. President, England does not propose for a moment to lose its favored position among the British dominions. The trade that has made England great shall continue and under conditions prescribed by England's ministers.
You see, it is along in here somewhere that there is likely to be some disagreement between you, Winston, and me. I am firmly of the belief that if we are to arrive at a stable peace, it must involve the development of backward countries, backward peoples. How can this be done? It can't be done, obviously, by 18th century methods.
Who's talking 18th century methods?
FDR.
Oh, whichever of your ministers recommends a policy which takes wealth in raw materials out of a colonial country, but which returns nothing to the people of that country in consideration. 20th century methods involve bringing industry to these colonies. 20th century methods include increasing the wealth of a people by increasing their standard of living, by educating them, by bringing them sanitation, by making sure that they get a return for the raw wealth of their community.
Around the room, all of us were leaning forward attentively. Hopkins was grinning. Commander Thompson, Churchill's aide, was looking glum and alarmed. The PM himself was beginning to look epileptic.
You mention India.
Yes. I can't believe that we can fight a war against fascist slavery and at the same time not work to free people all over the world from a backward colonial policy.
What about the Philippines?
I'm glad you mentioned them. They get their independence, you know, in 1946. And they've gotten modern sanitation, modern education. Their rate of illiteracy has gone steadily down.
There can be no tampering with the empire's economic agreements.
They're artificial.
They're the foundation of our greatness.
The peace cannot include any continued despotism. The structure of the peace demands, and will get equality of peoples. Equality of peoples involves the utmost freedom of competitive trade. Will anyone suggest that Germany's attempt to dominate trade in Central Europe was not a major contributing factor to war?
Okay, so then, I'll end the recording here. It does go on, and the whole book is available on archive.org. But the next day, they continue their dialogue. This obviously doesn't get resolved. And this will be the last interchange between the two men. Evan, you're up. Never mind. The following day, Elliot describes how the conversation continued between the two men, with Churchill stating,
Mr. President, I believe you are trying to do away with the British Empire. Every idea you entertain about the structure of the post-world demonstrates it. But in spite of that, we know that you constitute our only hope. And
his voice sank dramatically.
You know that we know it. You know that we know that without America, the empire won't stand.
Churchill admitted in that moment that he knew the peace could only be won according to precepts which the United States of America would lay down. And in saying what he did, he was acknowledging that British colonial policy would be a dead duck, and British attempts to dominate world trade would be a dead duck, and British ambitions to play off the USSR against the USA would be a dead duck, or would have been if Father had lived. Right? Okay, so what was the nature of the fight here? So the New Deal demonstrated in proof of principle something in America. It demonstrated that the American system, in its essential character, was the only system that was legitimate. It wasn't a communist versus a free market capitalist battle, it wasn't something like the von Mises school versus the Keynesian school, which was set up in the London School of Economics. It wasn't that type of battle either. State versus free market. It wasn't that. It was empire versus sovereign nation state. It was the idea that man is made in the image of God versus man is made in the image of mud. It was much more principled. And so the internationalization of the New Deal was the nature of that fight. What I have here are just several of many leading figures working very closely with FDR who understood this fight, much like Henry C. Carey did with his international pro-Lincoln network in his day, 100 years earlier, 80 years earlier. On the upper left, what we have is Harry Hopkins, one of FDR's closest confidants with Stalin, who had been deployed to really organize the setup of the import-export bank, as well as the preparation of an international New Deal, of doing what was done with America, with every other nation, South America, Africa, you name it. Keep in mind here, during this period, world leaders, Kwame Nkrumah, who we got to see a class on from our friend Nick Jones a few weeks ago, Kwame Nkrumah, who who was a major leader of the Pan-African movement, studied in America and really closely studied the Tennessee Valley Authority, understanding that this is what was needed to be applied to get real independence for Africa. So Harry Hopkins is there. You have Sumner Wells, the grandson or great grandson of Charles Sumner. And he really was very proud of that heritage that he had from his family, and Charles Sumner specifically, who was a major ally of Lincoln and somebody who fought very, very much in the post-Civil War era to internationalize the Lincoln system, the American system. Sumner Wells was the Undersecretary of State and also traveled internationally to prepare for this, meeting with leaders from the Arab world, Middle East, South America. And another person who did the same thing was Wendell Willkie, who's also there. There's two pictures, one with him and Stalin, one with Wendell Willkie and Chiang Kai-shek. Wendell Willkie was the head of the Republican Party. He was FDR's opponent in 1940 for the presidency, and he became FDR's leading Republican ally. He was known as the Republican New Dealer, and FDR recruited him to become the New Deal ambassador for the world. He did two international voyages where he went to, countless countries, meeting with the intelligentsia of every one of these countries to prepare them for a situation of post-colonialism. Below you have the figure we've already met, who began as agricultural secretary of the U.S., Henry Wallace, and then became vice president from 1940 to 45, January. And then you have Harry Dexter Waite on the bottom right, is a figure who I think is very underappreciated, highly slandered, slandered more so than I think anybody here on this list, even though they're all slandered by historical gatekeepers that usually you'll find affiliated with the Council on Foreign Relations and other roundtable organizations. All of these figures are today called communist spies or whatever. Dexter Waite was FDR's champion at Bretton Woods in 1944 in New Hampshire, where he fought for 2 weeks against John Maynard Keynes, who Keynes represented the Bank of England at that time, and fought for the British model of Churchill to create a bancor, a one world, essentially a one world top-down form of currency that would control all other currencies, controlled by the Bank of International Settlements and the Bank of England. The bancor was the name of this means of trade, of paying all balance of payments and exchanges. Dexter Waite was an opponent of that system, and he was victorious by ensuring that the U.S. dollar, which was the only solvent functional nation in the world, aside from Canada, really, that came out of World War II. Every other nation in Europe had been annihilated. So the U.S. dollar was made the basis of the exchange rates. Every nation had to have a certain amount of U.S. dollars, but it wasn't the U.S. dollar, and it wasn't gold or the gold reserve system that made it valuable. It was the fact that the U.S. had established very high degrees of free energy in their system, anti-entropy, as Lyndon LaRouche would say, in the productive powers of that society. That's what gave it the reliability and the growth potential to continuously make more qualitative advancements in productivity and science. That's what infused value back into the currencies. which economists who are just thinking like accountants, they can't see it because it doesn't exist in the numbers. Dexter White understood this and was an anti-imperialist. He was the first also U.S., the first head of the IMF, the first director, until his death in 1948 under mysterious circumstances. I think that there's a story to be told there. So these figures, you could read the speeches, the books that are available from all of them, and you'll find the same spirit that you got from Henry C. Carey, Lincoln, Sumner, Seward earlier on, McKinley, FDR himself. It's the same spirit. One example, just to give you a taste of this, from the book One World that Wendell Willkie wrote upon returning from one of his first international tour. Wilkie writes, in Africa and the Middle East, throughout the Arab world, as well as in China and the whole Far East, freedom means the orderly but scheduled abolition of the colonial system. When I say that in order to have peace, this world must be free, I'm only reporting that a great process has started which no man, certainly not Hitler, can stop. After centuries of ignorant and dull compliance, hundreds of millions of peoples in Eastern Europe and Asia have opened the books. Old fears no longer frighten them. They are resolved, as they must be, that there is no more place for imperialism within their own society than in the society of nations. Keep in mind, like, Willkie was also a major proponent of the League of the, not the League of Nations, the United Nations, and the Charter of the United Nations, which Vladimir Putin has recently called must organize and inform the emergency P5 talks that must happen soon, ideally even before the upcoming elections, to reorganize the world economic and security system. This, the UN, the United Nations, as envisioned by the architects, was not at all the same thing as the League of Nations. It was not some way to transcend sovereign nation states. It was always based upon a platform for dialogue and a zone of, if you look at its charter, the sovereignty of nation states is enshrined in the UN charter itself. It's not a way to supplement nations. Also the idea of harmonizing economic affairs to the welfare of all people is also built into the UN charter directly. You can read this. So it's not, even though it's been abused by imperialists over the last seven decades, its principles are sound, just like the U.S. principles are sound in spite of the treacherous imperialists who have often occupied the positions of power in the United States over the years. Now, all of these nice words are nice words as ideas, but if you want to really get at how they were planning on instituting, actualizing these broad goals of ending colonialism, it's important to look at the Russia-China-U.S. alliance, which again has to be brought back to the forefront today. Henry Wallace in Our Job in the Pacific writes, it is vital to the U.S., it is vital to China, and it is vital to Russia that there be peaceful and friendly relations between China and Russia, China and America, and Russia and America. China and Russia complement and supplement each other on the continent of Asia, and the two together complement and supplement America's position in the Pacific. Very different anti-Hobbesian idea than what we see coming out of the CFR today. In another piece, he writes, Two Peoples, One Friendship in 1944. He's still vice president. He says, very importantly, of all nations, Russia has the most powerful combination of a rapidly increasing population, great natural resources, and immediate expansion in technological skills. Siberia and China will furnish the greatest frontier of tomorrow. When Molotov, that is Russia's foreign minister, was in Washington in the spring of 1942, I spoke to him about the combined highway and airway which I hope someday will link Chicago and Moscow via Canada, Alaska, and Siberia. Molotov, after observing that no one nation could do this job by itself, said that he and I would live to see the day of its accomplishment. It would mean much to the peace of the future if there could be some tangible link of this sort between the pioneer spirit of our own West and the frontier spirit of the Russian East. He's invoking I mean, again, when you read the writings of Gilpin from 80, 90 years earlier, or a lot of his allies like Sergei Vita of Russia, there is a common understanding that you have this manifest destiny spirit in both America and in Russia, which is non-imperial. It's not subduing the weak or man versus nature. It was a much more ennobled idea of making civilization better, elevating all people in equality to access their innate potentials for development, and making nature better. You know, you don't have to just change nature in ways that make nature worse. That's possible. But you can also do things, if intelligently, in ways that enhance nature's own productive powers and cycles, which we've seen through things like, the Imperial Valley in California is one example under Roosevelt's New Deal, which brought in mass desalination, irrigation, water development, which took a desert that had no life, not a lot of molecular cycling of minerals, of water molecules or anything, so there's not a lot going on in this desert in California, and turned it into the number one fruit growing region in the world in a very short period of time. So, which had a lot more activity, a lot more biodiversity, a lot more green. So if you want to be green, why not green deserts like the Sahara, as Roosevelt envisioned in his book, or in Eliot's book on As He Saw It. He goes through his vision of taking the Imperial Valley program and applying it to the Sahara. This is what people like Gaddafi tried doing recently in Libya with the Great Man-Made Water Project, to take underground water aquifers and bring it to the surface as the eighth wonder of the world. Until NATO destroyed that vision and his leadership. This is what China is doing today with its water projects, like the Move South Water North project in China, or a lot of what they're working on with African friends. So this is where things were going in 1944. Unfortunately, something happens. Roosevelt alludes to his understanding of this something that is in danger of happening, but he makes some miscalculations. Documented again by his son, there's a 1944 discussion where Roosevelt says to Eliot, you know, or Jerry, how about you read Roosevelt again?
Okay. You know, any number of times the men in the State Department have tried to conceal messages to me, delay them, hold them up somehow, just because some of those career diplomats over there aren't in accord with what they know I think. They should be working for Winston. As a matter of fact, a lot of the time they are working for Winston. Stop to think of them. Any number of them are convinced that the way for America to conduct its foreign policy is to find out what the British are doing and then copy that. I was told 6 years ago to clean out that State Department. It's like the British Foreign Office.
And he goes on in that quote, I didn't include this, to say that, Eliot, I have become the only person I can trust. it's that bad. but I mean, so what happens? Well, remember all of these faces that we saw, right? These international New Dealers. Unfortunately, Roosevelt dies in, as we know, April 12th, 1945, just after winning his fourth mandate. So he's taken out of power, and there's been a bit of a soft coup in preparation, such that earlier on, just a couple of months earlier in January, Wallace is ousted as his vice president, and a Wall Street stooge named Harry Truman is brought in, who is very much like a Theodore Roosevelt character or a Andrew Johnson character, one of these typical little British puppets, or British-loving puppets. So he's brought in now to take over control of the presidency. Harry Hopkins dies, his heart gives out in 1946, the year later. Sumner Welles was taken out in late 1943 through a scandal orchestrated by Cordell Hull and a group of Rhodes Scholars embedded in the U.S. State Department. Wendell Willkie, who there's records of discussions that Wilkie had with Roosevelt to set up a third political party in America after the war. This would, I think, likely have been the Progressive Party that Henry Wallace ran with. Wilkie dies of a heart attack in 1944. So he's taken out, leaving really only Harry Dexter White and Wallace as the leading champions. Unfortunately, Wallace is now he's Commerce Secretary. He's still in government, but at a highly reduced level of influence. They couldn't fully take him out right away. And yeah, I'll say something about him in a second. So it's really just him and Harry Dexter White, who's now managing the IMF, but he's being sabotaged because the whole organization at this point is swarming with foreign operatives and vipers who are preparing to completely take over the World Bank and the IMF, which they were originally meant to be tools like the Reconstruction Finance Corporation in America for the International New Deal to emit long-term low-interest credit for big projects for the developing sector. Just a few other items here. I didn't mention this, but in August 1945, just a couple of months after Roosevelt dies, nuclear bombs are dropped on a defeated Japan. Douglas MacArthur later on describes how he was completely unaware. He was in opposition to this, but the one world government fanatics who were lovers of Churchill that Roosevelt warned about were on top of it and ensured that a new order of mutually assured destruction and global terror was going to come out, defining the world order after the end of the war. One of their obstacles to advance their dystopian agenda was the existence of patriotic elements dominant in the U.S. intelligence service. So the OSS, the organization of strategic services that was formed during World War II, was disbanded, and a mass purge is begun of all intelligence operatives who are allied with the International New Dealers and understand the nature of the bankers' dictatorship. Within less than a year, the Iron Curtain speech is launched given by Churchill, and the Truman Doctrine is imposed, and this basically creates the new Anglo-American special relationship, and the Cold War is officially launched. Henry Wallace, as Commerce Secretary, warns of where this is going, and he says, "Fascism in the post-war inevitably will push steadily for Anglo-Saxon imperialism and eventually for war with Russia. Already, American fascists are talking and writing about this conflict and using it as an excuse for their internal hatreds and intolerances towards certain races, creeds, and classes." In another place, he writes, "In the Soviet mission Asia, before the blood of our boys is scarcely dry on the field of battle, these enemies of peace try to lay the foundation for World War III. These people must not succeed in their foul enterprise. We must offset their poison by following the policies of Roosevelt in cultivating the friendship of Russia in peace as well as in war." And at this point, Wallace is soon fired by Harry Truman for being a Russian stooge, not trustworthy. He's ousted from government, and it gets worse. So yeah, Wallace is fired September 1946 after writing these articles. March 1947, so you now have the official Truman Doctrine, which basically puts the U.S. military and intelligence at the disposal of MI6 and British intelligence in such a way that the newly dissolved British Empire, which has now become a Commonwealth, these former colonialized countries that seek independence, everything is going to be done to ensure that they don't get independence. And if political independence is conceded, economic independence will not be conceded. And a lot of leaders around the world will die defending their right to have economic development and New Deal type policies in their countries in the ensuing years. September 18th, 1947, the CIA is created now to replace the disbanded OSS. That's a year after the OSS is taken down. Now, August 16th, 1948, Harry Dexter White dies, and the IMF now is totally hijacked. That was the last anti-imperial leader of the IMF. And Cynthia brought this up in her wonderful paper on the enemy within, on the purge of U.S. intelligence, that was published on Strategic Culture a few months ago. It's a really great paper. But she pointed out in that place that in 1950, the National Security Council Memoranda 75 is created, which is essentially a directive to save the British Empire. It uses the logic that with the newly independent nations that were formerly under the British Empire, they will easily fall under Soviet spheres of influence unless the U.S. can recapture them in any way possible and keep them in the Western under our side of the Iron Curtain. It's disgusting. So who's coming out against this? Well, in 1948, when Dexter White dies, he dies doing what? He's in the middle of campaigning for the presidential victory of Henry Wallace. Henry Wallace has taken sort of, you could say, a last stand and represented one of the last great hopes until JFK that America had to break this British takeover of America. And he runs with the Progressive Party. He runs alongside supporters and advocates like Paul Robeson, the great baritone singer, dramatist, scholar, and also co-founder of the Pan-African movement. Paul Robeson did more than people realize politically during this time and afterwards. So Wallace, while he's still running as a candidate against Truman, he's working with Harry Dexter White. Dexter White dies when leaving a House on Un-American Intelligence Committee hearing, which had him grilled, false witnesses testifying that he's a Soviet agent. He keels over and dies of a heart attack. Wallace ends up losing. There's a lot of operations against the Progressive Party. He loses that fight, and America is really at that point hijacked. There's efforts to revive this policy, of course. There were some elements of Eisenhower's policy that attempted in various small ways to revive the FDR vision, but not very successfully. Eisenhower was not a very wise strategic operator on this level, even though he warned about the military-industrial complex in his outgoing speech, which is very important, and he did provide very important briefings to a young John F. Kennedy, who was the incoming president. As did Charles de Gaulle, who was becoming a smarter man by this time and was advising JFK. We know the story of JFK. The anniversary of his assassination is coming up soon. Some articles will be written on the Rising Tide site dealing with that. All this to say, there wasn't a lot of hope. And in around the year 2006, I first encountered an image participating in a Schiller Institute conference featuring the World Land Bridge of rail all around the world. This is just it really struck me that this idea was even out there. I didn't think, I personally thought that this was purely a creation of the Schiller Institute, and indeed it was. I don't think Gilpin's maps were very well known at that point. But it's an idea of high-speed rail development and development corridors stretching all around the world in as a driver for a new just economic paradigm. At the time, this was a conference in Ottawa that I had first attended, and I saw this. It took me a while to fully grasp the importance and magnitude of this gorgeous idea. But there wasn't a lot of hope in my mind that this would ever happen. America was under the control of Dick Cheney, and there wasn't a lot of fight in America, as far as I could see, of any sovereign impulse. Under Obama, it got even worse. And then Trump happened, and we have a dark horse candidate with a lot of vipers who came into influence around him a few years ago in 2016. But in spite of that, President Trump has demonstrated a consistent intention to fight against, to push against this British infiltration, this deep state operation inside of the United States, and has undone a lot of the globalization policies that we've seen contaminate the world over decades. His reassertion of national sovereignty over NAFTA is an important policy. where NAFTA didn't allow sovereign nation states any role to play in economic affairs, under the newly arranged U.S.-Mexico-Canada trade agreements, nation states can now play a role. So you can have a protective tariff. You can direct, you can have dirigistic policies for the first time legally. The undoing of the TPP in the Pacific is an attack, which was an attack on China, and an empowerment of the corporatocracy was one of the first things Trump did in office. And the policy of reviving the American system, I mean, in spite of the fact that he hasn't been able to go very far, largely because he's been under constant attack and threat of coup, of overthrow since he's been in office by Russiagate and other, you know, he's a Russian stooge, all these things. In spite of that, he's the first president on record, as far as I know, he's the first president on record to speak openly about the American system, which he began doing in Kentucky in 2017, calling on the revival of the Hamilton, Henry Clay, Lincoln American system. He's spoken about Roosevelt, so he's not playing the party politics game of Democrat versus Republican. He's stated that Roosevelt's program is what America needs today. He's talked about JFK's space program and acted upon that in ways that other presidents have basically ended in only words, to reactivate the NASA dream, but with 21st century tech under Artemis. McKinley, like I said, was the last president to do this. This is very important. So what we have now with, since 2013, since we have the the Russia-China alliance, the Belt and Road Initiative was announced by Xi Jinping. This thing has blossomed in incredible ways to involve over 140 countries who have signed on to the Belt and Road Initiative framework. This is in all means of practice and principle, the same policy that Franklin Roosevelt, as well as Lincoln, Henry C. Carey, Ben Franklin, Leibniz, fought for in their own day, of ensuring that investments are tied to high-speed rail, real development that uplift the standards of living of people. And as you see in this image here, the Polar Silk Road that was announced in 2018 by China as a northern extension of its east-west New Silk Road corridor, involves bringing not only maritime shipping through the Arctic, but also increasing rail extensions through Eurasia into Russia, where Putin has announced a very ambitious Eastern vision, an Arctic vision for really developing science frontier cities in Vladivostok, Novosti, and other Arctic cities. This is going to be bringing rail all the way up to the Bering Strait within the coming decades. So this is reviving and giving new meaning to the Gilpin Cosmopolitan Railway and to the railway, the World Land Bridge that the Schiller Institute has been fighting for over three decades. On the right, that's a CNN screenshot of a 2011 announcement, or 2015 announcement, that was made in the China People's Daily, or was it Xinhua? Anyway, that China has essentially endorsed the Bering Strait Rail Tunnel. Russia revived in 2017. Putin announced that Russia was willing to invest $60 billion into the construction of the Bering Strait Rail Tunnel. It required only participation by Canada and the U.S. specifically. It was re-announced in 2011, re-announced again in 2015. So obviously it's on the table. It's really the lack of political will and Donald Trump having his hands tied that's really preventing this, as well as an economic system set to blow. So again, just to compare Schiller Institute World Land Bridge, Gilpin World Land Bridge. Schiller Institute World Land Bridge, Gilpin World Land Bridge. It's an idea whose time has come. So in Canada's case, we are, many of us here on this call and who will be listening on YouTube live in Canada. I figured I'd just do a quick little image here of the Alaska-Canada Railway. For those who have read the material on the Canadian Patriot history sites, they know of Premier W.A.C. Bennett, who fought between 1952 to 72 to build hydroelectric dams and rail in British Columbia, always in opposition to the technocrats in Ottawa who prevented this from happening, but he made it happen. The story is told in our website. And to this very day, the rail lines stretch all the way up to Dease Lake in North BC, but there's still a 1,000 kilometer gap where there's no rail connecting Alaska to BC. It's nothing there. So that today it's slandered as the rail to nowhere, or as Cynthia pointed out, it's kind of like the Canadian Seward folly. People give William Seward a hard time for having purchased Alaska from the Russians in 1867. Because there's nothing up there. Why would he waste all of that taxpayer money buying this piece of land? It's like, no, well, there should have been something up there if Seward and Lincoln's vision had gone through. So Bennett had talked about, had fought for a connection with Alaska, with rail. That's very important. He had allies who were governors in Alaska at different times who wanted this. Hickel was the most recent governor of Alaska who recently died, who fought really hard for this over years. So this is something which needs to be accomplished. Today there are only private consortiums. There's a new one actually that's very interesting. They have a website trying to build this. Since they're getting no support from the federal level, the private sector recognizes that the resources that are available up in the Canadian Arctic but are inaccessible because there's no roads, no rail, no nothing. It's a worthwhile investment that would play in very well to an international Belt and Road Initiative. In the Middle East, what you have is a picture here of the Belt and Road designs through what's called the Five Seas Vision of Bashar al-Assad that was first announced in 2004 and again re-announced in 2009 as Gaddafi was building the great man-made water project of Libya with the help of Mubarak in Egypt and of Bashir in Sudan. This, I think, image was commissioned by Hussein Askari of the Schiller Institute again, and this image demonstrates the reconstruction policy that would tap in very well to China's Belt and Road that is really beginning to grow in the Middle East, and it provides really the only hope that the Arab states have for a real reconstruction and a return to sovereignty. This is the New Deal, the international New Deal we were talking about. The Bashar al-Assad Five Seas Vision involves rail and roads connecting the big water systems of the Persian Gulf, Red Sea, Mediterranean, Black Sea, Caspian through Aleppo in Syria, and that would connect down into Beirut where there's ports in both countries that are part of the Maritime Silk Road and with extensions around, not yet through Israel and Palestine, things are a little bit too chaotic there, but through Jordan around it into Africa. Vital ideas that are beginning to become alive now. And finally, as far as the manifest destiny idea of the 21st century, I've alluded to it a few times. The Artemis Project has a wonderful website, wonderful videos, and it really showcases the right spirit of non-militarization of space that these patriots within NASA, like Jim Bridenstine, are committed to. So there's obviously a fight within U.S. space policy between real patriots who are fighting, who have shaped the Artemis Accords and want an anti-military approach to space as a zone for win-win cooperation, resource development from the moon, from Mars, from asteroids and beyond, versus the military-industrial psychos who want to militarize space and just have geopolitical rules of behavior extend themselves into space as a way to have full spectrum dominance over Russia and China. So that's where we're at right now. The next couple of weeks are decisive. There are huge clashes, dangerous clashes that are bringing us, as Martin Seif said in his recent speech yesterday to the conference, a few seconds to midnight on the atomic bulletin, the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists doomsday clock. B-52s circulating over Ukraine and being responded to by Russian fighter jets, 9 of them, on Thursday. These are very dangerous maneuvers, and we're playing with fire. So with the anarchy in the U.S. Threatening to basically do what the Confederates of the 19th century failed to do, with a huge coup d'etat British operation on being conducted against President Trump, with a planned Green New Deal global new London conference of 1933 run by the City of London being planned again now under Mark Carney, who's running the Canadian economic reforms with Freeland. there's a lot of historical precedents all coming to a head. Trump is, again, he's got a lot on his shoulders and a lot of vipers within his own administration, neocon psychos like Pompeo, Esper, and others who would love nothing more than to undermine this positive vision for where the world should be and could be if we're smart.